Hey guys, Andy here, and today on Q&A to Japandy, I'm going to be answering your questions about using the GI Bill abroad in Japan. So I got all the questions prepped up here on my computer, so with that said, let's get into it. And the first question comes from Tu Novia. Hey boss, I'll be applying for undergraduate degree in South Korea using my dad's post-GI Bill. So do I have to enroll at a university in America to use the GI Bill, or do you think I can apply to South Korean universities, specifically Seoul National University, as a full-time international student? Thank you. Well, too, and I hope I get that name right, I'm kind of bad with names. Yeah, for using the GI Bill overseas, you do have to apply to a university and go under some kind of degree program. So, one of the things that I learned the hard way when using my GI Bill is that I can't go for like a student exchange program. I actually tried that when I was first starting out going to Western Michigan University. I even did a whole video talking about all the Japanese exchange programs that that particular university offers, but because I was on the GI Bill, I couldn't take advantage of any of those programs because that program wasn't specific to my major at the time, which was Management Information Systems, which later got changed over to Film, Video, and Media Production. So because neither of those majors meshed with the exchange program, and the exchange program wasn't integral to my major, I couldn't use the GI Bill while doing the exchange program, so I would have to have found funding elsewhere, so that's why I didn't go to Japan that way. So if you're thinking about applying to a university in Japan, or in Tu's case, South Korea, you'll have to apply to the university directly. All right, and the next series of questions comes from Bro Is Brit. And she was actually the one who inspired me to make this video in the first place, so let's get on with the questions. So the first question from Brit is, I'll be finishing my BA degree in 2023, hey, that rhymes, and going to Japan to become an English teacher. Hubby is extending to a one-year contract, then getting out in 2023 as well. How can we get around being in dorms since we're married and do an easy process and transition with getting the VA? How long did it take to officially get BAH and book money and post 9/11? So there's a lot to unpack with that first question. So I will do my best to kind of break it down. So I mentioned in one of my GI Bill videos that some universities require you to go into the dorms for the first semester and then afterwards go and get an apartment or a guest house or whatever the case. But there are exceptions to the rule, most notably being if you already have prior experience living in Japan or if you're married. So since you guys are married, you won't have to worry about that whole dorm thing. Now, as far as getting BAH from the GI Bill goes, it all depends on how efficient your school is with sending out your information, how fast you're able to get it to your VA rep, your VA liaison. We'll then send it out to VA, Veterans Assistance, Veterans Affairs, and how fast they are at processing everything. But in most cases, you'll see your first check at the end of the first month of the first semester. Now that being said, as far as school supplies, book stipend money, you usually get that pretty early on. I get that maybe about a week or two when I start. So there is a little bit of time in between starting the semester and when you actually get the book money. So if you're looking to use the money to buy books and stuff like that, and you don't have it with you in savings or from jobs or whatever, there are workarounds depending on the schools that you go to. Most schools have like a loan program. You just say that you're on the post-9/11 GI Bill or whatever. They allow you to take a loan out for the books, and then they give you, I think usually like a month or two to pay it off. And if you don't have your books type of money by then, you gotta be talking to the VA because they got some splaining to do. As far as getting the full BAH, you won't see that until the end of your second month, beginning of the third month, because that'll be your first full month back in school. So say you start in spring semester, like I said, mid-January usually, and then you'll go through February, full month, and that's what your GI Bill will be based off of, is the full month of February that you attend. Now, this also goes into other break periods like spring break and breaks in between semesters. That's why it helps to not entirely rely on the GI Bill, because, like I said, it does fluctuate, so make sure you have like a job or savings or something lined up to where you're not totally relying on the GI Bill for finances. And then the next question is, can my husband go for the straight work visa, and how long did it take to go from student to work visa? So at the time of this recording, I don't have a work visa. Right now I'm on what's known as a designated activities visa out here in Japan. So designated activities is basically just kind of a catch-all term. It's like an all-purpose or like a miscellaneous type visa. And it allows you to qualify to stay here in Japan doing a designated activity. So in my case, my designated activity is job hunting. With this particular visa, I can stay in the country for up to 6 months. I can also extend it for an additional 6 months, so I can stay in Japan for a total of a year to look for full-time employment. During that time, I can also do part-time work, or arobaito work, which is Japanese word for part-time, which, fun fact, actually comes from the German word for work, which is Arbeit. I believe I'm pronouncing that right. Just a fun little factoid for y'all. So basically, how long it'll take you to go from student visa to work visa all depends on how fast you can graduate from school and get a bachelor's degree. So once you get the bachelor's degree, then you'll qualify for a lot of the jobs out here in Japan, and you can just go from there. Now, as far as the process of switching over from a student to a work visa, it just depends on how fast you can get the paperwork out to your respective immigration center, and there's a lot of other factors involved with that as well. So I would give it a couple months just to be on the safe side. And your school should work with you on getting the paperwork and everything out there in a timely manner. So there's not going to be any hangups in between. And they'll also give you a temporary exception, basically saying that you're in the process of applying for a visa. So that's what they did with my designated activities visa as well. They gave me a little stamp on my Zairu, your residence card. They gave me a little stamp on the back saying that I'm in the process of applying for a new visa. But like I said, getting back to the student visa, you can apply for the arobaito exception, which allow you to work part-time work. With that, you'll be allowed to work up to 28 hours a week. You can work up to 8 hours a day on days that you don't have school. So if you want to work weekends, you can work a full 8 hour shift during days that you have school. I don't think there's necessarily a limit that I'm aware of, but most of the time, probably like 4 or 5 hours during a school day. And you don't really have that much time in between class and work anyway. So, you know, I would just do most of my work during the weekends anyway, is how I would do it. So another question from Britt. I tried to go on Lakeland's website to look up bachelor's for the husbando. He's deployed right now, but didn't show any bachelor's degrees. Is it a guarantee to find a job as a teacher once there? Do I just call up the school since I won't be going through a dispatch service? If so, then I could probably live in the outskirts of Tokyo and just take a train unless the trains are only in the city. Because I was thinking there's more space and it's cheaper to live on the outskirts. So now, as far as Lakeland not showing any bachelor's degree programs, at the time of this recording, they are redesigning their website. So once the redesign is up, and it's my understanding that it'll be up within a couple weeks after this video comes out. So if you're seeing this in the future, greetings. And it's probably already up by now. But once they get the new website up, it's also going to lead into the big announcement, the official public announcement, that Lakeland is going to be offering bachelor's degrees at their Japan campus. So just stay tuned, and it'll be up there. Now, as far as where to live out here in Japan, I could make like a whole video dedicated on this by itself. But for the sake of brevity, I would personally say it just depends on what you're comfortable with, how much money you have and are willing to spend, and just where you want to be. You know, there's a lot of people out there who really love living in Tokyo, and they love the busy go-go lifestyle and being close to a lot of different job opportunities, a lot of different cool areas of Tokyo to explore. And a lot of them have their friends and network and stuff out there. So if you're comfortable living in the big city and living in a little shoebox for a lot of money, relatively, then, by all means, go for it. But For me personally, I love visiting Tokyo, I love being near Tokyo, but I don't actually like living in Tokyo. So for me, I would recommend living on the outskirts of Tokyo, especially if you want to save some money and live with a reasonable amount of space for not a whole lot of money. So that's why I've moved outside of Tokyo. Time's recording. I live out in Kawasaki, which is the closest city to Tokyo without actually being in Tokyo. It's part of the Kanagawa Prefecture, which is just south of Tokyo. And right now, I live in a private room guest house. I pay about $450 USD, roughly. So very cheap, very affordable. If I was married, I would definitely be looking more towards living in an apartment versus a guest house, just because you get more room and it just makes better sense. So the next question from Britt: can you give me any ideas of local areas in and around Tokyo to look for a house or apartment to rent? What websites are good? Going to start learning Japanese soon, but I don't have it down at all, so I need some English friendly and easy to use. So the obvious picks would be like Gaijin Pot. They also have a job board up there too, so you can look for some gigs to get you started. It's not the ultimate best website out there, obviously. There are other better alternatives out there, but it'll be enough to at least get you started in finding a place. Now, if it was just you, I would definitely, like I said, recommend going into a guest house because it's cheaper. And you can go to different guest houses. They're a lot more willing to work with foreigners, a lot more flexible. So if you find that you're not really liking living in this area or whatever, you can much more easily move to another guest house versus going from apartment to apartment, you know, just based off of leases and stuff like that. So guest houses are a very flexible, very affordable way to live out in Japan without spending a whole lot of money. And if you don't like the area, you can always move. As far as learning Japanese goes, the schools out here in Japan do offer Japanese language courses. So if you want to get serious about learning Japanese, you could go that route or just make some Japanese friends. So next question from Tikio Sam 2. Andy, come back. I'll pay you $3 an hour to edit. I miss you. Who let this ham bone in the comments? All right, so getting back to Britt's questions. How would he, her husband, go about getting the waiver through the school, or when he gets the visa, would he get it? Can he make a video on some of these topics? Funny you mention that. So as far as getting your arubaito waiver, exception, whatever you want to call it, you basically just get that once you get your zairu card, your residence card, and most people get that as soon as they land in Japan. So just mention the arubaito paperwork. They just usually have a thing there that you can fill out, or you can just fill it out beforehand, but I just recommend filling it out in front of them just so that way they can help you through the process. And then when you go and reapply for a different visa, as long as it's not a work visa, like if you get a designated activities visa like I do for job hunting, you can also apply for the arubaito waiver as well through your local immigration office. So you just basically have immigration take care of it, and just take care of it there because it's easier to do and you're already there for paperwork anyway, so why not, right? Alright, so next question from Britt. Okay, so I'm continuing to research information for my husband since he will be on the GI Bill. So how can I get my husband to be able to go to school there for 4 years? Every time I keep looking it up, it says that you can only have a student visa for 2 years because of residency issues. This is very much confusing me. I'll be there on a work visa, so I'll be fine, but I don't want him to have to up and waive and go back to the US. But as far as student visas go, usually they last for about 2 years at most, and you can extend your student visa if you're going for a four-year program. So once your visa is about up, you can get paperwork from your school that you can take with you to immigration to renew your visa. So it's very easy, just keep an eye on the time. And if it starts getting a little close, talk to your school, or most likely if you got a good school, they'll talk to you. But definitely keep track of that, that way you can get the paperwork and get going from there. And so Britt's next question Also, my husband is extending his contract for a year so he can use TA, tuition assistance, to be a mechanics associate's degree. Basically like a trades degree or certification, something like that. Just something useful that he can actually get a job in case this all doesn't work out, or maybe even a job there in Japan. Should he not, and get something that will transfer over to the university over in Japan, that way he will only have to complete his junior and senior years of school. But we wanted that maxed out BAH for 4 years while I was getting my foot in the door of schools, so that would really help us out. Now I'm kind of at a loss. There's a whole lot of questions that I could ask about that particular situation, because ultimately it just depends on what he wants to do long term. What job field does he want to get into? What does he need the degree for? So if he wants to be a mechanic or something like that, then I just recommend he go that route and just finish his schooling in America. Then once he has that all done, if you guys still want to go out to Japan, he can do that. But if that's just a fallback plan, I would recommend just coming out to Japan, getting your education out here. All right, and the last question of the video comes from Amanda Senpai. Hey Andy, I have another question. Realistically speaking, if money wasn't an issue, how many times a year could you go back stateside to visit family while attending school in Japan? Not considering old Colony Macaroni. Like, do you have a good amount of time between semesters and whatnot? Thanks for any info. So, with old Colony Chan World Tour aside, you do have a month in between semesters going to Lakeland. I don't know what it is for the other universities, but you can look up their academic calendars and put two and two together. But for Lakeland, you have about a month in between semesters. So if you do decide to go back home to visit family and whatnot, again, Colony Macaroni aside, let me make that clear. You do have plenty of time to, you know, go back home, visit family. Or if you want to take a semester off, like if you want to take summer off instead of going through the summer semester, you can do that as well. Just got to make sure, if you are taking a semester off, to let the school know so that way it doesn't affect your visa when you return. So yeah guys, that was Q and Andy Japandy, GI Bill edition. I want to thank you guys for tuning in to this super long video. Had a lot to get into with these questions. And if you guys have any questions about Japan, whether it's GI Bill stuff, life out here, going to school here, whatever, sure to leave them in the comments down below in the boopity boops, and I will do my best to answer them. But with all that said, this is the Andy-san. Signing for now, and as always and forever, we'll see you next time. Catch you later, guys. Bye.